Good morning to all. Mi nombre es Ricardo Avila, soy el director.
My name is Ricardo Avila. I'm the director of the Journal on Economics and Business of Portafolio. I will be the moderator of this panel regarding how to cope with corruption. Before beginning, I would like to make a couple of announcements. First of all, that the panelists will have the possibility of speaking in their language of preference, English, Portuguese, or Spanish. There's interpreters for those three languages. And likewise, this session will be streamlined and broadcasted in streaming. And we will hear your opinions, and we will open up the floor for questions from the audience. And I would like to refer to the possibility that you ask your questions via some digital media. You have to remind me the address, Marisol.
.ch/ask. I'll say it again. Web.ch/ask.
Web.ch/ask. That is the address. I will be getting them here if that is the case. You will have the possibility of asking your questions physically here, or but those persons who are watching us on TV will, or on their computers, will have a possibility of using this technological tool. I would like to introduce the panelists: Thelma Esperanza, Aldana Hernández, Attorney General of Guatemala; Juan Carlos Botero, Executive Director of the World Justice Project in the United States; Sergio Romani, who is the Chief Executive Officer for South America region of EY, based in Brazil; Elizabeth Ungar, who is the Executive Director of Transparencia for Colombia, and who is also a member of the International Board of Transparency International in Bogota; and Brian Winter, who is the Editor-in-Chief of America's Quarterly, based in the United States, particularly in New York. There is no doubt, when we look at the surveys or the news, that the issue of corruption is covered every day. I was telling the panelists that a couple of minutes ago, I got through my cell phone the news from the New York Times saying that the entire Russian athlete team has been suspended from participating in the Olympics because of a scandal in the indiscriminate use of doping. So that is a scandal that touches sports right now, and it's an example of how corruption is present in our day-to-day life. When we look at the surveys, especially in the specific case of Latin America, the Latino barometer, this issue of corruption is part of the concerns of the citizens, and sometimes it is the first source. And it is an issue that has its consequences. And in the concrete case of Latin America, it is true that the attitude of the population has been evolving. To my left, I have a concrete example, which is the case of Guatemala, from whom we will hear. But if we look at recent news, we will see it what happened in Brazil not long ago that implied the suspension of President Dilma Rousseff on a case that you all know well. Without further ado, I will first of all ask Brian Winter to give us his general thoughts on the region. He has had a chance to work in several countries, and I think that he can give us an overall vision that is very interesting. Brian, you have 3 minutes.
Corruption has been around in Latin America, as in other parts of the world, for centuries. But I think we'd all agree that something different is happening right now. You see the most dramatic examples of this in Brazil, where I live for the last 5 years, and also perhaps in Guatemala, a story that many people in this room know quite well, including, of course, Attorney General Aldana. But it's happening everywhere. You see it playing out in Chile. You see it playing out in Colombia. In Mexico, of course, there's wide diversity across the region in terms of the force with which corruption is being addressed, but something has clearly changed. So I'd like to talk very briefly about what has changed and why I think this secular change in terms of the tolerance of corruption and the exposure and punishment of it is taking place. To do that, we have to go back a little bit. Basically, if you look at the region as a whole, you saw a series of positive reforms to the economies during the 1990s. And then you saw, especially in the South American sphere, the positive effects from the commodities boom of the 2000s. The net result of this was about 50 million people who came out of poverty region-wide and into the middle class. And for these people, hand-to-mouth issues like unemployment, basically, became less important, and they became more interested, and their countries as a whole became more interested in the quality of government, in rule of law, in benefits to the tax dollars that in many cases they were starting to pay for the first time. So I think that's one of the factors. The other one is democracy and the way that democracies across the region have consolidated over the last 30 years. How interesting, for example, that Brazil began its transition back to democracy in 1985, which was 1 year before Guatemala went down the same road. And during that time, you've seen independent judicial institutions in particular take root that are not compatible, basically, with corruption. In the case of Brazil, the constitution, their democratic constitution of 1988, established the public ministry as basically an independent judicial body, the U.S. equivalent of the district attorney, or the attorney general, I'm sorry. And they were given the opportunity and the independence to begin rooting out some of these old corrupt systems. And it's taken a while for their efforts to bring fruit, but my goodness, I think we'd all agree that they've dug up quite a case right now. And then finally, as far as the factors go, I think you can't underestimate the importance of social media. Whereas many of these cases in the past would have been buried either by traditional media or not really exposed to the degree they were, the electorates, people in general, are so intolerant of corruption and have really decided corruption is enemy number one. Even in a place like Brazil, where amid the worst recession in 80 years, if you look at polls and you ask people what the number one issue is, they say it's corruption. So there's huge hunger for a resolution of this as well. We can move on, I suppose, later to discussion of where all this is headed. I would just say that, you know, I personally see this as a very positive process, as much disruption as it produces in the short term. I was just in Mexico, and I don't want to pick on Mexico, but I'm going to mention this case because I was just there. I had so many people come up to me, you know, knowing that I'm, you know, mainly a Brazil follower, and they said, gosh, we cannot wait to have a Lava Jato in Mexico. And I sort of said, you know what that implies, right? And they said, yeah, you know what, like, we know what it implies, we know it's disruptive, but we have to get those elements out of our politics. And so I think that's where it's headed, but as I always say, success is likely but not guaranteed, because there are very powerful forces in Brazil, elsewhere in the region, that are pushing back against these changes. And so I think it remains to be seen how lasting and how significant the change will be.
Muchas gracias. Juan Carlos Botero.
Gracias.
Thank you. When we think about corruption, comparing the region, the organization where I work, if we measure the issue of corruption in 180 in 20 countries during the past 8 years, we think that corruption is only one animal. It's only just one thing, but no, it's many. It's corruption in the top ranks, favoritism, partisanship. That's very different from corruption at the level of the police officer, etc. So to give you an idea about the location of the region in terms of figures, the perception of corruption in Latin America is generalized. But when you look at the perspective of the individual, the perception of corruption versus the direct experience of having been a victim of having involved, been involved directly in an act of corruption, and the figures are totally different. For example, corruption by police officers, the perception is that 50% of the citizens in the region believe that the police incurs in corrupt practices. But when you ask, did you have a direct experience with this, then the figure goes down to 27%. If we put this in context with other regions of the world, that same figure in Eastern Europe and Central Asia is 43%, and in Sub-Saharan Africa, 68%. Obviously, in Europe, it's 9%. So what we see this is that Latin America does have, in general, high levels of corruption, but they're low than in other parts of the world, particularly East Europe, Sub-Saharan Africa, and Southeast Asia, where the daily levels of corruption are higher. It's paying a bribe or a bribe, basically, to take the children to be able to get the children admitted at the hospital or things like that. But if we look at the structural problem of corruption in Latin America, focusing without a special reason, if we focus on Mexico. In Mexico, we have done a deeper study, and we found that at the level of the police, there are two practices which are particularly concerning. One is corruption to be able to be promoted within the ladder, the police rank ladder, and that generates crimes, etc. And the second one, which is highly concerning, is the favors, gender-related favors, corruption related to sexual type of favors to obtain promotions in an organization. This is very typical of the police, and it shows a very in-depth, an in-depth problem that we can discuss later on. Sergio Romani.
Improve a little bit more. So it's glad to be here. I'm going to give you a different perspective on fraud. In a Brazilian talk about fraud and corruption is something is not unique. I mean, it's our daily news. And if you open a newspaper and watch TV, every day we are discussing that, drinking a beer with a friend, discussion around corruption is pervasive all over the country. But unfortunately, we are in the spot of the world, in a bad situation right now. But I'm a believer that you're gonna emerge a stronger and more ethical country, as you said, Ricardo, after this Lava Jato thing. It's something that you have to go through to have a better country. And I do expect and I hope that we're gonna ripple through the whole region, the whole Latin America, as a good example. But I'm gonna give you this perspective of an audit company that has been working with for more than 30 years. And before I take this role as a CEO of South America region, I was what they called assurance managing partner, which comprises audit plus an area of fraud and investigation services. 4 to 5 years ago, we were like 30 professionals working basically in Brazil, someone in Chile and in Argentina, but basically focused on Brazil. And then at that time, what we was doing is that basically answer the phone when a client had an issue with fraud and go there, try to help them to identify how it happened, who did it, and how much, and try to help them to build the forensic accountants to provide to the SEC and DOJ, basically international, multinational clients. Brazil didn't have a legislation under a specific legislation of fraud. 4 to 5 years later, we are 400 professionals, close to 400 professionals in South America, Peru, Colombia, Brazil, Argentina, and Chile. And the company has moved from a reactive approach to a most preventive approach. So we are basically right now doing investigation, like in Petrobras, for example. We are doing this, helping this Lava Jato with some lawyers. We are there with more than 200 people investigating or helping to investigate, which is an amazing thing. I mean, it's really, if you go through the newspaper, it's unbelievable what happened in a company like Petrobras. The deterioration of Petrobras is we cannot believe what happened there. But we are also are very busy helping clients now to implement processes trying to minimize the risk of fraud. And not the risk of the current risks, but mainly or also the emerging risks of fraud. With cybersecurity, this is something that's going to be new because fraud is being sophisticated every time and every year more and more. When you think about the fourth revolution, digital is going to bring some additional risk for companies to mitigate those. So we are very busy helping companies to implement processes like whistleblowers. That is something new. And we are helping companies to staffing there because there's a lack of specialization here in South America mainly. We are bringing professionals from the US to train our people because we don't used to have the what we call CCO, Chief Compliance Officer. This is something new, or GRC, Governance, Risk, and Compliance. So companies are really implement those, and I'm very optimistic that I'm a believer, I'm an optimist, that I think companies are now reacting to the pressure that society is doing and government. When you think about the anti-corruption summit that happened in London in April, it's clear that a huge commitment to government all over the world to trying to combat corruption. So I guess, not I want to pick in Brazil, but as a Brazilian, what I've seen there gives me the sensation that it's going to emerge different in this region in the upcoming years. Something's going to change.
Muchas gracias. Fiscal Aldana, cuéntenos un poco de Guatemala. Pasemos a los casos nacionales.
Why don't you tell us something about the cases? Well, as background, I wanted to tell you that Guatemala suffered an internal or domestic armed conflict between 1962 in 1996, according to the Commission for Historical Truth, approximately 200 people died, approximately 1 million displaced and refugees, 45,000 disappeared persons, or missing persons, around 80% are Mayan origin. Guatemala is multi-ethnical, multicultural, and plurilingual. And it was the native peoples, the ones who suffered the most the consequences of war. In 1996, we signed the peace accord, firm and durable. We complied with the signing part, but we have not really found a road for that peace, and it has been everything but long-lasting. Within that context, we have the emergence of the SIACs, the illegal security groups, which have led the government of Guatemala to request in the UN the creation of a commission. In this case, it's the International Commission Against Impunity in Guatemala, ICC, and it was initially conceived as an agency that was going to lead the investigations. But with those functions, it would be unconstitutional, said the Constitutional Court. And so we have decided that it would be there to support the effort of the public ministry in Guatemala. So in 2015, we took to the courts of the country the case that is called as La Línea, the line, which involved the vice president and the president and the former vice president of Guatemala. And that was our biggest case. Yet this month, for example, we have taken to court another case, which is the cooptation of the Guatemalan state, which reflects how the Patriot Party, political party, was created structurally, criminally, to take power, to take office, to come into power. And in the Guatemalan state, they performed a series of illegal activities that show how rampant the corruption is in Guatemala. The positive side is that we are taking to court those persons who, according to objective and transparent investigations, are responsible for that corruption. So the challenge for Guatemala is now to take advantage of that historic moment to achieve an alliance between the public sector and the private sector and the civil society to reach that peace which we have been having pending for the past 20 years. Thank you, Mrs. Prosecutor. Now let's listen to Elizabeth Ungar. Well, I want to begin by what the prosecutor has just said, in the sense that the process that is making its way in Colombia of signing the peace and the post-conflict era, one of the main obstacles that can emerge along the way is precisely corruption, because peace building is all about building trust, of recovering the presence and the trust of the citizens in this, in its state, in its government. But corruption is a question also of human rights, of poverty, of citizen security. And those are things that are at the heart of the peace-building effort in a country like Colombia. And the risk of corruption should be tackled since now. In other words, carrying or struggling against corruption in the post-accord era is something that we cannot postpone. And we are already implementing programs and executing resources, and we believe that the necessary measures to armor those resources against corruption are not being taken. It is necessary to identify, and we have been identifying those corruption risks that are going to continue, risks that are already exist, and they are not going to disappear because we sign an accord. The worsening of situations that are already present, and possibly the appearance of new corruption events stemming from new actors, from other actors that come to fill certain spaces in the country. Issues like, for example, things that we have to pay attention, special attention. Politics, the financing of campaigns, the way of accessing power. We know that a point two of the Havana Accords talks about social and political participation. We believe that it is absolutely key to open up space for new actors, including the FARC actors who are signing the accords, to participate in politics, yes. But we have to know what kind of resources they are going to use to fund their campaigns. And something that is very important, what are the practices that are going to be used by the various actors? New social movements, a guerrilla itself, and the traditional actors in the field of politics to access power, to exercise it. Now, resource handling, we are next to seeing thousands of millions of dollars that are flowing in from not only the resources from the national budget, but also local and regional budgets, but also international cooperation resources and resources from the private sector, too. There's already some commitments on a part of the corporate sector of Colombia to invest in productive projects for peace building. So we must all make sure that all these resources land where they should. And bipartisanship and the issue that the prosecutor was mentioning, we must shield these accords to a maximum. And we have been asked for some concrete proposals. First of all, to determine the institutional administrative arrangements to implement an anti-corruption strategy for this purpose from now, because we cannot rush this. In the second place, to design a corruption mitigation plan in the post-conflict era aligned with this strategy. We have to do this now, and we have to have it clear where the main corruption risks exist. What are the mechanisms that are going to be effective in mitigating these risks and attacking the problem? We have to design a training program and citizens' lookout systems so that they can follow up on the Havana agreements and commitments and establish a system for proactively and permanently disseminating these results and being accountable to the citizens about the resources and the programs that are going to be implemented during the framework of the post-agreement. And we must work on a greater coordination, interagency coordination of those agencies in charge of investigating and preventing and penalizing corruption events. This will be a fantastic way to create a virtual circle of cooperation between the private sector, the government, and the citizens. In Brazil and Guatemala, it has been shown that a society that mobilizes and is demanding is a good way out and a good solution. Thank you very much. I want to remind our audience that they can send me their doubts or questions if they use the link wef.ch/. I would like to ask Ryan. There's people who have a certain level of cynicism regarding what is happening in Latin America. They say, well, this is not the first time this happens. Obviously, a scandal comes up. You do a sort of cleaning, and actually, the old habits continue to be there. In the concrete case of Brazil, there's all the arguments that beyond the exit of the Workers' Party from the government, all the workers are part of a very similar structure. What do you have to say about that?
People especially are asking themselves right now, and maybe in Guatemala too, right? Was this just an exception, or is it something that will continue and that will result in some kind of systemic change? I think, you know, I take inspiration from basically two things. One, the dramatic events that have already happened. And in the case of Guatemala, as the Attorney General pointed out, this is a country that in many ways is quite fragile. And what they did in 2015 with, essentially convincing or inducing a sitting president who was quite popular to step aside, have his immunity stripped by Congress with massive support from popular demonstrations on the street without a drop of blood being shed, that's remarkable. And I think it speaks amazingly well of the Guatemalan people and also the Guatemalan institutions, such as the Attorney General's office and the CICIG, which were able to gather the concrete proof that was needed to cause that change to happen. So, you know, you look, and of course, similar story in Brazil with the Lava Jato investigation. The other thing, and this is just from somebody who travels around Latin America and who has spent 10 years of my life living in various countries. I've lived in Argentina, I've lived in Brazil, I've lived in Mexico. You travel around the region right now, and like no other topic, corruption makes people sit up straighter, right? I mean, no matter where you go, this is very front of mind for people. And I just think, and especially among younger people, and you see it in polls, you see it in concrete actions. I don't think it's going to go away. I just think that because of the factors that I mentioned earlier, I think that the corruption to the degree that you saw in Brazil, for example, is incompatible with the age of the phone tap, the flash drive, and the ballot box, I don't see how it continues. And part of what we're seeing right now in Brazil is the clash between, you know, remnants of the old system that have stuck around even though Dilma Rousseff was suspended from power, now clashing against this still continuing wave of evidence that is coming from plea bargain testimony and from phone taps.
Fiscal, quisiera comentar usted un poco sobre el tema de Guatemala en el sentido que de cómo evitar que...
Mrs. Prosecutor, would you like to tell us something about how, what to do to prevent these things to repeat themselves? Well, that's a great challenge for the Guatemalan government, for the president who just took office in January of this year, and his cabinet. That is the great challenge, not allowing these criminal structures to strengthen again. Or to regain strength, because we were able to put in prison some people, and we don't want others to continue committing the same crimes. We know that it's worrisome in the case of La Línea, for example. We imprisoned 30 or 40 people, and 6 months later, we did a search. We executed a search warrant at the legal head of the superintendency, and we found more than a million quetzales in cash and documents. He had gone through the process against the president of the republic, against the vice president, against the head of the superintendence of the tax office, and he continued with the bad practice of corruption. And we found in his home a sample, an evidence of that corruption. I was surprised because one thinks that given the examples that are that we are seeing, people will wish to correct their attitude, but that's not what it is. So in Guatemala, we have to prevent and we have to continue investigating so that we can take to prison those people who are responsible. Juan Carlos, one of the questions that people ask is whether there is more corruption now than before. And you find that very often. The people normally ask that. But the corruption perception index shows a trend, an increasing trend. But if we cross it with the figure that you just mentioned, I remember, again, quoting the Latino barometer, where the perception of corruption and the verification of an act of corruption, there's a big difference. So what do you say when you're asked that question?
There are actually two things. The first is the effect of combating corruption and the harder the war and corruption, the greater the results. That is seen in literature. Why? Because when people are indicting the head of state, when they see that dozens of parliamentarians are put behind bars, when they see that, they think everything is corrupt. But the reality is quite the opposite. If we look at what happens when those events occur, what happens is that you have the institutional strength required for that to actually happen, because in those countries with the very high levels of corruption, that actually never happens. In those countries where there is no freedom of press, which is not the case for Latin America, even though there are countries where there is a lot of concern over freedom of the press, corruption is simply hidden. So the perception of corruption may be low because, you know, people know there's corruption, but you don't have these public scandals that heighten the perception of corruption. And that's very, very clear. That's the first thing that happens. Second, is there greater corruption today than before? I would say the opposite is true. I think that what we are seeing, thanks to this social transformation taking place in the last 15 years in general, in the last five in particular, is that 15 years ago, people in general had very little access to information, whilst today, thanks to social media, to smartphones, everybody is carrying, you know, one or two computers in their pocket. So access to information has become so generalized that the social pressure in favor of those changes becomes increasingly important. And when that is not taken into account, then we see the emergence of phenomena such as the revolution in Arab countries. The Arab Spring, for example, I mean, you know, many of the causes behind all these revolutions was this generalized perception of the people of corruption. And be this corruption high spectrum, and it continues to exist in Latin America in a prevalent manner. And generalized corruption inside the police and lower-ranking civil servants and companies participating in corrupt practices is something that is permanent. Well, I don't think it's increased. What there is today is greater awareness around the problem in the region. Yes, Elizabeth, but I would say that that greater perception of corruption delegitimizes democracy. And that ironically makes the struggle against corruption more difficult, with an additional emphasis that has to do with what you mentioned, which is the regional aspect. You know, in Colombia, there is this belief that decentralization brought a decentralization of corruption, among many other things. Yes, that is quite a paradox, because to the extent that the media are reporting more, that heightens the perception of corruption. Though I do not believe that corruption has dropped. It's become far more sophisticated. On many occasions, it's far more difficult to identify corruption and the perpetrators of corrupt acts. And what research reveals, I mean, research done all over the world, is that the effects of corruption in the most vulnerable sectors of the population, Latin America, Africa, Asia, and every country, continues to be, I mean, there is no declining trend. It rather, it has remained the same, or we see an increasing trend. And I would say that the topic of the decentralized corruption is part of a very interesting debate, which is whether centralization is a cure for corruption. My opinion is no. I believe that what we need to do is strengthen in the institutions, in the territories, in the regions, at a local level in order to combat corruption. But it's not centralizing anti-corruption policy and anti-corruption measures as the solution. I mean, there are certain national or federal agencies, but that in no way means that a re-centralization will solve the corruption problem in the regions. Sergio. Santa Inés de la Cruz wrote, who is more to blame for any wrongdoer? He who pays for the crime or has a crime that pays? I believe that the private sector, you know, incurs in corrupt practices, normally someone on the other side in the, you know, the public, if someone in the public sector is on the take, there's someone on the private sector who is at least promoting or accepting the blackmail. The trend in the world, particularly in more advanced societies, in respect of having stringer norms, but how does the private sector behave?
Try to anchor my response on this survey that we did recently, was launched in April 16, called Corporate Misconduct, Individual Consequences. This is brand new. I have some printed versions here if you want to. Otherwise, you can go to ey.com and download from there. And they really address what we just mentioned and this discussion of corruption increase or decrease globally. What these, which the survey found, is that corruption basically stays at the same. Perception of corruption has increased. When you look into the perception, globally perception of corruption in Latin America goes up to 91% of the people at the Global believes that in Latin America is a very fraudulent place to do business. But I mean, when you go into the details of this survey, you just asked me is that there's no much change in somehow some of the data is a little bit controversy that people still agreeing on paying bribes, mainly when you have a downturn in economy. People still paying bribes, I'm talking about CFO, CEOs, paying bribes to keep their business, get new business, get into a new business, get into a new country. So there is the perceptions, not the perception, the reality that this survey bring to us is that there is no too much change on it. Even in Brazil, and Brazil get worse, even with this Lava Jato, I mean, they have some high profile Lava Jato enforcement going on, even though people believe that, I mean, sometimes worth to commit a fraudulent act. But what I do believe that something gonna change in Brazil when you think about a billionaire like Marcelo Odebrecht, for example, in jail for 1 year by now, this is a signal that something's changing there. I mean, it's unbelievable. Usually rich people don't go to jail in Brazil because they can't afford to hire a very influential lawyer. So this is, you know, a signal that things are changing there and gonna change the whole South America, I believe. So, I mean, unfortunately, the survey doesn't bring us the same spirit of optimism that I do have living in Brazil and seeing behind the scenes what is happening there. Another very interesting data here is that people believe that corruption is somebody else's problem. 39% of the respondents believe that corruption exists in their own country, but only 11% believe it happens in each sector. So it means it's not exactly my problem. It happens here in Brazil, but not in my industry, not in my business. So, I mean, this is something that I have to really to keep working on. I believe that changing behavior and increased enforcement, that's going to be the solution for overcome corruption. Another detail that most of the people believe that what is going on in Brazil right now started with the Lava Jato. As a matter of fact, was not. Brian, I guess you remember that we're probably living in São Paulo. On April or May 13th, people going to the streets, and people, I mean, the society, there is no politicians involved on that. On the contrary, people were rejecting any politicians going there, going to the streets. I was there with my family, my kids, protesting against corruption, protesting against increase of tax, and not having seen return on my tax. So that's where everything started. Then on January 14th, Dilma enacted the what we call Clean Act, anti-corruption Brazilian law. And then only on June 14th, this Lava Jato comes up. And the Lava Jato comes up because of a whistleblowing process. So, I mean, things are really, I'm a believer that things is gonna change for the better.
Muchas gracias. Bueno, es tiempo de ofrecerles el...
The time has come now to open the floor to questions, and I'd like to ask attendees, if you have any questions, please ask questions, not make comments, and brevity will be appreciated. Orlando Machado from Brazil. And I would like to ask about the relationship between having, you know, a position of trust and corruption in Brazil. We know that only at a federal level there are 8,000 of these positions that the presidency is free to appoint and dismiss. So the question is, why does a politician want to be the director of Petrobras or Pemex through a technical person or someone from the sector? I mean, why do we have so many of these positions of trust, and what is the relationship between this position of trust and corruption? Who would like to answer? Elizabeth, you first. The issue of human resources in the public sector is a critical issue. At least in Colombia it is, and I'm sure that this is true for many other countries as well. Here, the figure of service contracts, I mean, people who are not, let's say, in the career path of the civil service is a matter of great concern, particularly when those people fulfill, you know, like mission areas inside the state. And on top of that, they are people who cannot be evaluated under Colombian legislation. They cannot be evaluated. So when the norm applies to personnel having service contracts and not having a formal employment contract, we have problems. And we have the revolving door problem as well as the conflict of interest. The revolving door is a practice that all too frequently occurs among all those civil servants who are not career civil servants, but are there because they have a service contract, and they rotate between the public and private sector, abusing the information they have obtained in their different positions, and they use them in their own benefit or for the benefit of a third party. And the lack of transparency in conflicts of interest is another very serious issue. I believe that this is a very important topic. However, I personally view corruption differently. I think that we should not look here and there at the different tools for corruption, but I would say that corruption should be viewed as a symptom. The patient has a fever. The problem is not the fever. The patient is what is causing that fever. So it's the institutional framework at large. An example, 30 years ago, Hong Kong had a very high degree of corruption, extraordinary, brutal. And today, it has a very low level of corruption. And the difference was made by one specific action, which was creating an anti-corruption action authority that had great powers and technological guarantees. Their technology is very important and also had all the tools to combat corruption. So the revolving door, even though it may be a cause, is just one of the elements in the components in a system. And you have to look at the system as a whole. The fact that in a country, the civil servant has a position of trust or not that can be appointed or removed, that's not the point, but that's just one of the variables of the system. So it's not the fever, it's the disease. I mean, what are we attacking? We should be tackling a system. Next question. In Colombia, we have had high-ranking executives working, you know, in anti-corruption, international transparency, but it seems that they don't have any teeth, any power, any muscle to make things happen. So what would you, Dr. Botero, recommend so that these institutions, these teams, will actually, you know, move from good intentions to facts? I would like to ask the Attorney General, Thelma, to tell us how to prevent this from becoming endemic. In principle, I believe that citizen participation is key and that the change in culture, you know, transitioning from tolerance to anti-corruption. In Guatemala, before 2015, you would say about a former mayor, oh, mayor so-and-so robbed, yes, but not very much. You know, he only robbed a little, or he only stole a little. Or mayor so-and-so, no, he was a real thief, but at least he left some works behind. And at some point, we even said that, you know, hopefully the next president won't be as big a thief as the one who just left. And so in Guatemala, we are highly tolerant to corruption. But today, fortunately, the people, the men and women of Guatemala, are fighting against that culture of corruption. And I believe that is what is most important, because that is the starting point for thinking about capacity building, strengthening the institutional framework, because in Guatemala, we have seen a perverse strategy, which is to weaken the public ministry, to weaken its budget, and only provide it with what it needs to barely pay salaries. And that's starting to change. In this administration, we have seen not just a change, but also some hope to strengthen the investigator and the justice courts and tribunals so that it is equipped with the legal and IT and technology it needs to combat crime. Thank you. Evidently, the topic of impunity obviously demoralizes a society when citizens see that, you know, people in power, there are no consequences for the people in power. They lose credibility. So the question is, since corruption has permeated the judicial authorities, attorney generals, what do you think could actually work in Argentina, in Colombia, in Peru, in Latin America? Could we, could we use a mechanism like the one used in Guatemala, ACC? Would that help combat impunity and get somewhere?
I think that there are different levels of tolerance for foreign countries coming in and setting up parallel judicial institutions. I think that in some of the cases of the, and forgive me for using this word, but for the more institutionally fragile countries in the hemisphere, I think that there was an obvious case to be made. I think that's why the mandate of the CICIG originated in Guatemala and has been extended. I think we've seen something similar happen now in Honduras under the guise of the OAS. The positive side of this is that I believe that there are a lot of countries around the region, Brazil certainly being a case of this, where there really is no need for a CICIG. The judicial institutions are strong. My gosh, I mean, look at what they've done. And I think that that work will continue. So I look around the region and I sort of know Brazil and Argentina in particular from having lived there for so long. That idea in places like that would just be dismissed out of hand. I mean, you wouldn't even start that discussion.
Sergio, una pregunta como brasileño puntual que me hacen.
Question I've been asked here online. Perception of Dilma Rousseff's suspension is corruption related, but actually it was budget management. Doesn't that weaken her image?
Because there is a law that's fiscal responsibility, and she didn't follow the law. I mean, that's one thing. But of course, when you have a country, all country merged in all this corruption, in claiming for against corruption, one thing is related to other. I mean, we're just discussing here, for example, sports, corruption in sports. Look at the Brazilian soccer team. What is going on with the Brazilian soccer team? For sure, there's something strange going there. I mean, we still know how to play soccer, but somehow we are not succeeding anymore. So there's something related or correlated to corruption when you think that our ex-former CEO of FIFA or CBF, Confederação Brasileira de Soccer, were arrested in Switzerland. So I guess always all of that is connected. And Dilma was, people are sick and tired of her. Because at the same time, this is like the Al Capone in the US. I mean, they were arrested because of their income tax, not because of all that has done. So it's, to me, it's quite similar what happened there.
Muchas gracias. Bueno, nos queda tiempo para una.
We have time for one more question that I want each of you to answer in less than 10 minutes, which is the time available. What to do in the future, you know? I think that the problem has been clearly diagnosed. I think that what's been happening in Latin American society is clear. Obviously, there are different results of different degrees. So the obvious question is, now what? I mean, what's the role of people? What's the role of youths? Who would like to start, Juan Carlos? So, what to do? There are lots of things to do. And let me tell you what we've been doing. The first, and I've met with anti-corruption agencies from many countries, and the truth is what is crystal clear is the autonomous investigative power of the anti-corruption agency is directly tied to the control of corruption on the long term. That is evident worldwide. That's very concrete. That's very specific. I'll give you an example. In Hong Kong, when they bring someone to the interview room, they have a machine that produces two CDs simultaneously. One is given to the accused, and the other is sent to the anti-corruption agency, and the third copy goes to Baca. So that prevents many of the things we see here. I mean, you know, the hearings, the technical side of the investigation is held back, and that's not the case over there. Something we saw in Tunisia was to engage people that are not part of the anti-corruption instance, you know, not just judges and lawyers, no, but bring on board engineers. 1,000 engineers were trained in anti-corruption. Doctors are interested in corruption in healthcare, engineers in civil works, to bring other social instances and bring on board all these different social sectors has proven very important to establish a common front vis-a-vis corruption. And the third, more specific, more concrete, is purely technology-driven. I mean, each person has a mobile phone. They have apps where they can denounce a bribe. The bribe happens in India. I mean, there are hundreds of examples. Come into our webpage and see them. And in those cases, the technological tool allows citizens to immediately identify the situation, and then there is a record. This is, you know, the $64,000 question, to be honest. I mean, first, to guarantee independence and strengthening of the state apparatus responsible for preventing, investigating, and sanctioning. And that includes, you know, how you are appointing, electing, or nominating the directors of control and investigative agencies. Second, strengthen civil society's ability to do social control, social oversight, and that requires direct support. And I think that the private sector can help support civil society oversight initiatives over public monies and works. And something that is somewhat abstract, but yet it's to hold authorities constantly accountable. The authority is naturally responsible for overseeing, preventing, investigating, and punishing acts of corruption. Sergio, the role of the private sector, I believe.
I guess we are doing our homework on that. I mean, I guess we are very well connected with government and support government's actions on that, and also listen to the society in responding to that. Again, when we were looking to what happening in London's anti-corruption forum, the sensation that I have is that more we talk, more we act. I mean, more the society act, more all this engine is working very well. It's just started. It's a long journey, a long process. This fight against corruption is really against very powerful and rich people that's going to react and try to keep the current status quo. But I guess we are in the right track, I mean, globally. I guess the alliance that is happening through prosecutors all over the globe, governments all over the globe, a civil society that's really gonna push this process on. There's no way that it can go against the wave. And that's, I guess, I mean, if you go through South America, everybody's sick about this corruption. Nobody can support corruption anymore. I mean, it's clear the opportunity that they have in this part of the world to eliminate poverty and certainly corruption is one of the reasons that we keep our country under the constant underdevelopment.
Fiscal, ¿qué viene para Guatemala?
Madam Attorney, what would you like to see in Guatemala? Or what would you like to see disappear in Guatemala? I don't know, to implement the democratic policy of Guatemala, democratic because its transversal or cross-cutting axis is the respect for human rights, and its pillars include prevention, sanctioning, investigation, and social reinstatement or reinsertion. I think that we must also work to, you know, hopefully achieve equality. There are certain groups that are still very vulnerable and are not, and the right, their rights, and that equality is not fully respected. And I think that both are very necessary.
Ahead.
Well, I'll try. I think the challenge is to get from the old thing to the new thing. Right? I mean, to get from this old structure where corruption was built into the system to get to a newer structure that is, you know, will never be totally clean, but certainly materially better than what existed before. And we see in Brazil right now just how difficult that is because Dilma is out, at least for now, but the structure that's still there is got some, you know, of the same flaws. So one solution to that is new names. And I think that, you know, people who are part of this modern, younger, perhaps, generation that have these values where corruption is not as tolerated, these people, they need to get off the sidelines and they need to get into politics. And that's risky. And there are certain things in Brazil, for example, the way lists for Congress are built, you know, there are structural barriers to that. But I would like to see more of these younger people across the region. This is true in my country, too, by the way. I mean, more people getting involved in politics. And then finally, you know, as far as the private sector's contribution, I think that the things that we've mentioned are important. There is a core element here, though, which is that I think the private sector needs to be more aware of the fact that what's going on right now, these processes that are painful in the short term, they are positive in the long term. And so, therefore, investment should not be put on hold or chased away because of some of the noise associated with this process. Actually, if you see a country where this process is taking place, that's where you should probably be making your long-term bet. And what we're seeing right now in some of these countries is actually the opposite. You know, people, investors, investments going down, people are scared away because they see volatility. I would prefer that the mindset change a bit and that they see opportunity associated with this instead.
Bueno, muy bien. Creo que hemos llegado.
Thank you very much. We've come to the end of our working session. I mean, there's hope. There's hope, and that's what I would like to take away from this panel. And there are ways of, you know, dealing with the fever. Let's hopefully implement corrective measures. And we, in the end, as citizens, hope that in a future WEF, we need not schedule a program on corruption because it's disappeared. Thank you for your participation.